In this project, I will showcase a tiny game that can be played right on the terminal with minimal graphics. The game logic is simple. The player controls a movable tank that can shoot at enemies with a goal to destroy them all. I will explain the entire process of writing the game program in the standard C programming environment without any external libraries. And the only graphics rendering tool we'll leverage is the printf function in the standard library. I plan to divide the project into three separate videos, and in this first video, I just want to cover the basics of rendering things onto the terminal and how to create basic animation. Specifically, I'll go over the code that renders the title screen of the game. So, I'm going to start from scratch. I have already prepared a C source file with nothing but a printf statement. Now you can see there's a bunch of extra includes, and we certainly don't need to use them all right now, but those will be needed for the full game. So I just want to declare them all for convenience. All of these headers should be available in the standard environment, and as promised, you don't really need to install anything fancy to build this program. I do want to mention though that the code is written for a Linux system. It should be easily portable to other Unixes, but if you're on Windows, I would recommend using WSL, the Windows Subsystem Linux, if you are interested in running this yourself. You certainly don't have to follow along if you don't want to. It's more about understanding the concepts and ideas involved, not reproducing the exact same code. I also want to mention that this is not a C programming tutorial by any means. It's not super advanced, but I would assume that you understand the basics of C, or if you have experience in a similar language. Of course, I will try my best to explain some of the language details as we go, but if you are a complete beginner without any programming experience in any language, you might still watch it, but you probably won't get as much out of it without doing extra studying on the side at least. Besides the source file, I've also prepared a simple shell script that will compile the source and run the output executable. This just makes it easier for me to test the program as we go. Of course, you can just manually run the compiler command if you are following along as well. It's very straightforward. For example, if I run it now, then you can see that it prints out the text on the terminal, and our environment should be ready to go. Now, when it comes to a game, we generally have to have a defined screen first. Since this game will be displayed inside the terminal instead of an actual window, we will need to have the program draw a border for us with characters. There are of course many ways of drawing the border, but let me show you guys what I have done for this project. So I'm going to bring some code I've written that can draw a border on the terminal. If you don't know exactly what I'm doing with Git here, it's totally fine. That's not the point of the video. All I did was merging some code that I prepared on a separate branch onto my current file so that in the editor you can see the diffs. And as you can see on VS Code, there will be colored highlights on the side on anything that has changed from the previous commit, essentially. And I will be doing these types of incremental merges throughout the video instead of actually coding because I feel it is more time efficient. And as I mentioned before, it is more about understanding the concepts rather than reproducing the code. And I will explain these changes carefully. Before I jump into the code, I actually want to show what it looks like when I run it so that you guys know what to expect. So when I run this code, you guys can see that it actually prints out the border. And this will be what defines our game screen. Everything that we render later will be inside of this border, and none of the game elements are allowed to go outside of it. So the code for it isn't super complicated. I have hard-coded the character strings that are the exact same replicate of some of these border lines. On the top, I also have a few macros that essentially just set some static variables for us throughout the program, like the width and height for the screen. There are also a few others related to the border size or the character boundaries. We're not going to use all of them in this video, but they will eventually help us do balance checks later in the game logic. So I thought it's useful to just have them here. Ultimately, these are just some numbers, and it's okay if you can't visualize all of the use cases for them now. I hope it's not too confusing, as they don't contain any logic. One thing of note, that the border character that I chose here is not a standard ASCII char. Of course, you can use a standard ASCII char if you want to make modifications, but I think this looks better. But since it is a special char, it takes 3 bytes in the program's memory as its code point is very large. And as you can see, when I hover over the string, even though I really only have 80 characters in the quotes, It tells me that the size is 241 bytes. And that's because of the fact that each character is 3 bytes, and there's always an extra null byte at the end of every C string, so you get 241. Besides the macros, here's a string variable that is quintessential to the entire game. And you will see how this is being used to render literally everything in this game. Basically, this is a 2D array of chars, or really an array of strings is perhaps easier to visualize. And this piece of memory will contain all of the characters that we will print to the screen. And I promise this will become obvious as we walk through animating things. But for now, all we have to do is to put border strings into the screen. And this is reflected in this string fill def function, where we, you know, first memcopy the first and then the last two lines into the first and the last two rows of the screen. And then in the middle, we simply run a loop to fill the rest of the body with just this line that can be repeated really multiple times to just extend the height of the border. And then this render function here is, you know, very straightforward. We iterate the screen row by row and print out each row with a line break at the end. With that, in the main function, we simply invoke these two functions, and then we see the effect of drawing the empty screen with just the border. Of course, before we can render the screen, we must first allocate memory, and that's why you see these lines over here. Remember, with this declaration, we have only statically allocated memory for 40 pointers, essentially, but no memory has really been allocated and assigned to each of these pointers. And so here we're just asking for enough space to be able to put characters into the screen, or otherwise we'll get segmentation fault when, for example, when this memcopy happens. A small note, even though the border character is 3 bytes each, everything else that we render here is only 1 byte. So we certainly have over allocated for most of the screen body here. And you can choose to resize them if you want to with additional logic. You can save some extra memory. But I feel this really is an overkill. It's not really worth to add that complexity for this little game. And also note that because we use calloc to get clean memory here when everything is zeroed out, we don't have to worry about, like, when we do character copies and moves that sometimes the C strings might not terminate correctly. Because of dirty memory that sometimes you will get if you just use a function like malloc. Okay, we have successfully rendered a border for our game. So now, to get to a full title screen, we just need to put in some extra text. This sounds quite simple, and yes, the graphics alone are indeed simple, but I want to present an extra challenge. We don't want to just display the title screen all at once. Instead, we want to animate the display to create an effect of live action. Remember, we will need to animate the game actions later anyway, so I think this exercise is an excellent intro to what comes in the next video. So here's where the fun begins. I am going to again bring the code that supports that functionality and also do a quick demo. Okay, so the code should be ready, and you guys should be able to see the divs between this and then the previous code just like before, which I'll explain in detail later. But now, let's first run it and see what happens. Great. The program now renders the full title screen with the game title and the instructions. But as I said before, if you notice, the display is being animated gradually rather than shown in a single frame. And that's the key here. Now, if you know a little about how animation is produced under the hood, you know there really is no magic here. Animation on the screen is never real. You know, it's just an illusion of rapidly changing frames. Essentially, what we want is to create a transition between two states where we produce a bunch of incremental changes and have them rendered at a certain rate, one after another, so that our eyes will feel, you know, something is moving. In this case, as you can see, we are creating the transition between this, you know, the previously empty border, and now this, the border with stuff in it. The program logic will essentially fill out this screen, but one line at a time, and then render them in succession with a pause in between each render so that the transition feels like animation. And the pause is definitely necessary, otherwise the game runs too fast. So let's take a look at some of this code. So first of all, you can see that I have again prepared some hard-coded strings that represents the game title and then the instructions. Those would just be simply substituted into the screen memory where previously we just have empty body. So that, you know, when we print out, you will see the full text. Nothing is really new here, very similar technique as before. And there are some extra defines to guide us on, you know, which rows of the screen these are supposed to be inserted. I've also defined a FPS that would determine how many frames we want to render within a second. And you can see it is here being used in this pause function, and then plugs into the uSleep function that will halt the program for this many microseconds. And because it's in microseconds, that's why you see this 1 million here divided by the FPS to give us the pause time between frames. Just think about it, the math should work out. Now here's another piece of important detail, which is this clear screen function. You might wonder why this exists, and I don't know how obvious it is in the demo, but realize that when we render these frames, we can't just keep printing more stuff onto the terminal, as that would just keep scrolling down your terminal rather than refreshing your screen with a new frame. Actually, let's take a look at this again. I'm going to actually slow down the animation a bit with just 5 FPS, and now watch carefully. Right, so notice that all of the frames are rendered in the exact same location, and that's important. And that's why we have the clear function to essentially reset our cursor back to the beginning so that all of our frames are rendered in the same place. Once you understood that, now I can tell you a bit about the fundamental sequence of our game loop at a very high level. Every game is essentially a loop. You're waiting for player input, apply some changes to the game state, usually some memory, based on the input and, of course, other game logic. You render the current game state onto the screen, and then you pause a bit, and then you rinse and repeat for every tick or frame of the game. Of course, these steps happen very fast in a computing environment, and that creates that interactive experience. Now, if we jump into the main function here, you will see that the body has essentially been replaced with just this run title screen function, which performs that exact sequence. We orchestrate the animation with 40 frames equal to the height of that screen, right? Since we're creating transitions line by line. Forget about these lines for now, I'll explain later. Just focus here. You will see that at the end of each iteration that we do a clear render and then pause. So here, the clear has been integrated into the render function itself, but the idea is just the same. Before we render something, we first check if something has already been rendered previously, and if so, we're going to clear the screen first. Now, I know the code for clear screen looks rather cryptic, and that's basically true. It's unfortunate. Just consider these two lines as a magic sequence that will erase a single line and then move your cursor back once executed or printed. So doing this for each line will essentially clear the entire screen. So I think now, there's just one more piece of logic that needs to be explained, which is these if statements. And they're not that complicated. Remember, our goal is to generate intermediate frames with partially filled screen. So we have a row counter that we can use to keep track of which row that we're currently on for the iteration. And here, when we come down to these lines where the game title is supposed to be displayed, then we're just going to, you know, mem copy in the appropriate string on the appropriate line into the screen. And also remember that the memory is not being cleared automatically after each render, right? And then we use that to our advantage here because we don't need to erase everything after we render something. We just keep incrementally copying more characters into the screen as we move down. And for the instructions, it's basically the same logic. And so this logic will make the screen filled with the right data during each frame, And then all we have to do after that is just to render and then pause. And then that would complete our text animation. I hope that makes sense, and definitely think about it if it isn't obvious. But just understand the key here is to put the right data into the screen memory, render and pause and then repeat. And this concept is really the core, not just here, but for the entire game. So it is really beneficial for you to have a solid grasp on this concept. Before I conclude, I want to add a small, I guess you can call that a call to action feature. And this is certainly an optional part, but I feel it makes the title screen, you know, more lively. So we're going to make this press E to continue text flash, which means we're toggling the display periodically. Again, let me bring the code so you guys know like what I'm talking about. And I promise like this will be a fairly quick addition. So now the code is in, and you can see this is like the only addition here, and everything else is virtually unchanged from before. Now, if I run it, you can see that this line of text is flashing, right? Which is kind of cool. Now, if you have digested what I have explained before, adding this feature should be a piece of cake. So if you're interested, I would recommend that you pause the video here, maybe to think about, like, what would you do if you were to implement this feature? Like, what would you do to make this happen? Of course, I'm just going to show you the answer here. So all I did is to add this additional while loop after completing the title animation. Remember, the title animation is not changing here. I kept a tick counter, which increments in each iteration. And then there's this title tick that defines the essentially the duration of the cycle. So in here, it's set to 8. So in every 8 frames, the display will toggle. And the toggle logic is very simple. Just mem copying the text line into the memory to make it show, or the empty border here to make it disappear. So the program will just be running in a cyclical loop between these two states where everything else is unchanged. Again, you see the clear and pause at the end of every iteration. So now the game is kind of stuck in the loop rather than quitting after the animation. So now I have to kind of force interrupt it. So, you know, because we don't have input control yet. Now, we are pretty much done with the first video. I will give you guys a quick look at the end at the full game, which I do have a copy of, to just showcase what it looks like when everything is put together. So here we go. As you can see that the title screen is virtually the same as we have already completed here. Now if I press E, the game will start, and now you can see I control a tank starting at the bottom right with a bunch of enemies spawned on the top. I can shoot at enemies. They will take 2 hits to die. I have also limited the amount of in-flight bullets, so I can't shoot indefinitely until they go away. And if an enemy touches me like this, I'll die. So that's it, quite simple. And we will discuss what it takes to make that happen over the course of next 2 videos. The next video, I think I'll go over how to handle user inputs inside of the terminal, as well as drawing game objects and maybe some movement controls. And then in the 3rd video, we'll go over the core game logic. Things like enemy AI, how to fire shots, collision detection, and some other fun stuff. So I hope this is useful. I will definitely link this code in the description for your reference. Let me know if you have any questions in the comments, and I'll be happy to answer them or address them directly in the next videos.